ओके, स्क्रीन विजिबल है, स्टार्ट करें। ओके, सो लेट्स बिगिन द सेशन। दिस इज लेक्चर नंबर 33 एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट यूनिट 3 मेमोरी मैनेजमेंट पार्ट 1। इन द लास्ट यूनिट वी हैव रिमेनिंग वन टॉपिक मैसेज पासिंग्स, सो वी विल डिस्कस लेटर। So let's begin the session, memory management part 1. So first question arises in our mind, what is the basic need of memory management? Why we need memory? What is memory management? These kind of questions may be asked in GTU. Write a short note on buddy system. Buddy system is just like a memory management technique. So let's discuss first introductory part of memory management. Then we will understand the need of memory management. Why operating system required memory and why it is need to be management. Memory is cheap today. We know that in today's era, memory are so cheaper and getting cheaper, but applications are demanding more and more memory. There is never enough. And it is also known by us that day by day, memory becomes cheaper, but the application demanding more and more applications. In last years or in last some years, we have run so many applications which that does not require some memory locations. It requires only 1 GB and 2 GB. But you know that the latest technologies required 4 GB RAM, 8 GB RAM. That is the minimum requirement or specification of applications or some framework. So as applications era is developing more and more, it required memory more and more, and still it is not enough. It will be increasing day by day, maybe, and within 2 or 3 years there may be a 16 GB RAM or 32 GB RAM. There are so many applications can be generated or developed which specify it required 16 GB or 32 GB of RAM. Memory management involves swapping blocks of data from the secondary storage. We know that if any program wants to run, if any program wants to execute, it has to be come from secondary memory to primary memory. So memory management refers both the terms whenever we required primary memories. So whenever we talk about the management or memory management, we are dealing with the primary memory locations. We are not talking about the secondary storage. So memory management involves swapping blocks of data from secondary storage. Secondary storage means we are talking about hard disk. And whenever we want to run our program, execute our program, we have to swap out our program from secondary to primary memory. So there is one purpose, swapping blocks of data. If you want to perform the swapping, we have to have a memory locations, and it should be a primary memory. It should be a part of primary memory where we want to swap our block. If we do not have a locations, we cannot swap the block or program from a storage, secondary storage to primary memory. Memory input output is slow compared to CPU. Another requirement of memory management: if some programs resides in primary memory, then CPU will come work efficiently. But if we do not have a memory, if we do not have the proper size of primary memory, then we cannot compare the speed of CPU. Because CPU cannot directly deal with the secondary storage. If our program is stored in secondary memory, CPU cannot directly pick data or program from secondary storage. It always deal with the primary memory. So somehow we have some required space in the primary memory so that CPU can interact with the primary memory or CPU can interact with the data with, that are stored in the primary memory. So it is also possible, it is also true that speed of primary memory is not compatible with CPU speed. There are a world of difference between the speed of primary memory and the speed of CPU. But still, there is another concept which is known as cache memory and internal registers. So that provide a faster speed as compared to primary memory. So second need, why we need to memory management, why we need to memory, because we want to maintain the speed of CPU. The operating system must cleverly time the sweeping to maximize the CPU efficiency. Memory needs to be allocated to ensure a reasonable supply of ready process to consume available processor time. So here the definition of memory need. Memory needs to be allocated to ensure a reasonable supply of ready process. We already learned about the states of process. There is a process state called ready, which contains some processes, and we have to supply primary memory that are available in the ready state process. So after the ready state, there is a next state called running state, and that running state having a lot of memory area, and in that area, we can sweep the process from ready to running. So that is why we need to memory, because we want to shift the process which are stored in ready state and we want to execute that process. So we have to shift from ready to running state. And running state is all about the primary memory locations where CPU is allocated to the process, operating system allocated some resources to the process, and process gets executed in that environment, and finally it terminate. Now, explanation part introduced by pointing out that is in a uniprogramming system, main memory is divided into two parts. Basically, there are two kind of environment. First is uniprogramming system and second one is multiprogramming system. In both the cases, operating system will deal differently. And we know that operating system must be stored in the primary memory, then any programs can get executed. So if we talk about the uniprogramming system, there is a one part for the operating system, which we call a resident monitor or kernel. And the one part for the program currently being executed. So if you understand, let's open MS Paint. Memory management technique in uniprogramming. So in uniprogramming system, there is a two section. There is a two section, first and second. This is the section of operating system, and this is the section of user's program. So in uniprogramming system, there is a two partitions, you can say. The whole primary memory is divided into two parts. First, we will load the kernel part, that is the operating system. Not exactly the operating system, we will call it a kernel because it is the core part of operating system. We cannot load the entire operating system in a limited size of primary memory. So we have to write here kernel. That is the core part of operating system. And it may be load in the top of the primary memory section, and it may be load in the bottom of the primary memory. But it is true that there is two partitions, first for kernel and other part for user's program. But nowadays the scenario will change. In multi-programming system, kernel area is one specific primary locations, specific part of primary locations, but user program is divided in different section. So one part of the operating system, this which is called resident monitor or kernel, and other part for the program currently being executed. So this is the two part of uniprogramming system. In multiprogramming system, the user part of memory must be further subdivided to accommodate multiple process. As I told you, in the multiprogramming system, the user's program is again divided into different part of segments, different part of memory sections. Some partition techniques may be applied on user's program. But in previous time, there is only two sections, one for kernel and other for user's program. And there is a limitation. Suppose if the user program, or you can say the second part of primary memory, let's suppose it is 20 MB size, and let's suppose a single process, process one, that size is suppose 10 MB. The size of 10 MB process will occupy the entire user program's area of 20 MB size. So rest of 10 MB will be waste, and it will not allocated to other processes which might have a less size of 10 MB. So if process one enter into the user's program area or the second part of primary memory, then it will occupy the complete space. It doesn't matter, the 10 MB is still remaining and we can allocate to different process. It is not possible in the uniprogramming system. So in that case, the 10 MB of memory will waste. MB size of memory will be wastage, right? We cannot allocate, we cannot allocate 10 MB size of memory to process that requires 5 MB size of memory. So this is the drawback of uniprogramming system. That's why we have to switch on to the multiprogramming system, and there are so many partitioning sections or partitioning technique need to evolve that divide the memory in different partitions, and we can use that partition for our program. So I hope you understand there is a disadvantage of uniprogramming system. The entire process gets covered the entire locations. If it is 1 MB, then again it is occupied the 20 MB locations, and it will not allow to enter second process. Rather, we have 90 MB space remaining, but it's still the 90 MB memory location cannot allow to store different process context. If process 1 gets terminated, it releases the memory, then we can allow another process to enter into the user's program area. So at a time, it is allow only one program. That is why it is uniprogramming system. So in entire locations, only one process can use by this memory locations or memory size. If it is 20 MB, then it is enough. We are utilize the memory. But if the size of process is less than 20, then the rest remaining part of the program, remaining part of the memory will get waste. So it is again evolved. We need to evolve the different technique or different memory management technique. Emphasize that memory management is vital in a multiprogramming system. We know that in a multiprogramming system, memory plays a vital role, very important role. If only a few processes are in a memory, then for much of time, all of the processes will waiting for input, output, and the processor will be ideal. So we know that if limited process are there, then we cannot utilize the processor time. Processor gets ideal always. So somehow we need to maintain our different processes in a primary section, primary memory, so that processor will be utilized. That's why we need a memory. We want to utilize the processor. That is the need of memory. If we have a proper memory, if we have the larger size of memory, we can have n number of programs, and n number of programs can run simultaneously, and processor gets utilized in better way. So thus memory needs to be allocated to ensure a reasonable supply of ready process to consume available processor time. So this is the introductory part. Let's summarize. Why we need memory? First, we want to store. Want to store process in memory. That's why we need a memory. Second task, we want to utilize. We want to utilize to the CPU time. That's why we need memory. Third, we want to perform multiprogramming. Then again, we need a memory. We want to swap or we want to perform the sweeping, where we can take some data block from secondary memory and put into the primary section. So again, we need a primary memory. So we can say we want to perform swapping. That's why we need a memory. Then last we can discuss there is a world of difference between input output devices and speed of CPU. So these differences will reduce by the memory. So input output devices enter the data in a primary memory. CPU will do a different task during the loading of data, and once the program gets loaded into the primary memory, CPU deal with the primary memory and gets data for execution. So in that way, the CPU gets utilized. Otherwise, there is a world of difference between the speed of input output devices and the speed of CPU. So we can reduce the speed of input output devices and speed of CPU by using the memory concept. So this is how we need a memory, why we need to manage the memory, and why operating system required to management of memory, because operating system do certain lot of things as we have discussed here. And there are two kind of system you have to describe in the memory management: uniprogramming system and multiprogramming system. In uniprogramming system, there is only two section of primary memory. First one for resident kernel, resident monitor, you can say. Monitor is just like a kernel which monitoring all the processes that's executed in the user's program area. You can say kernel also, because each and every activity performed by the kernel in our programs. So there is only two section of primary memory. First is resident monitor, or you can say kernel, and the second portion, that is a user's program. But remember, there is a limitations of uniprogramming system. If single program load in the user's program area, it will occupy the entire space, right? And the program that are loading into the user's program area, it always less than the size of user program's area. So suppose we have the 20 MB, the size of user program area, or the second portion of primary memory, then it will load less than 20 size of process or program. And remember, if it load by one process, other process cannot be load. So there is a limitations, but in the multiprogramming system, again there is a two section, but the other section can be subdivided into different part, which will we recall the partitioning technique in upcoming lectures. So in multiprogramming system, there is a section which is called resident monitor and kernel, and other portion was user's program, and user's program's area will again subdivided into different section, and each and every section used to store the programs and process for execution. So we can have n number of process simultaneously, and CPU will execute so many processes at different times. So this is the benefit of multiprogramming system. Now let's understand a memory management technique called buddy system. Entire space available is treated as a single block of U raised to the power U. If a request of size s, where 2 raised to the power u minus 1 is less than s, is less than equal to 2 raised to the power u, entire block is allocated. Otherwise, block is split into two equal bodies. Process continue until smallest block greater than or equal to the s is generated. So let's understand by the diagram. In theory section, maybe you will not understand how body system will work, but in graphically we can understand properly. So let's understand. We have an entire block of size 1 MB, 1 MB of block. This is the availability of memory, right? Like in the current era, we have minimum 2 GB and 4 GB and 8 GB of memory size. But in previous, after 5 or 10 years, we cannot have a larger memory size. We can have a limited size of 1 MB, 4 MB, 256 MB in this way. So let's suppose we have a size of memory 1 MB. And we want to perform the body system on that memory so that we can execute more than one program. This is not the example of a uniprogramming system. It is a different techniques which is called body system, which allow more than one process, but it will divide the memory locations depending upon the request of process. So let's see how body system work. Now start from, we have 1 MB block of size. Request of process is 100K. So 100K, what we will do, we compare this, 100K is less than 1 MB. Yes, it is less than. Request is in kilobyte and availability is megabyte. So it is quite a smaller process. It requests quite a smaller size of memory. So can we divide it into two sections? If we have a 1 MB of block, can we divide it in two sections? We know that 512 and 512 kilobyte combined, it create 1 MB. Let's understand by the diagram. We are discussing body system, and body system is memory management technique. So let's suppose the available memory, available memory size is 1 MB. Let's create a one block, and this block refers the size of 1 MB. 1 MB. Now we will start execution of process, and let's suppose there is a process number one which requires 100 KB. We can say 100K. K stands for kilobyte. So 100 KB is quite a smaller size of memory that are requested by the process one. So this request will be compared by 1 MB. So 1 MB is quite larger and 100K is quite smaller request according to the size of memory. Now what we will do, if we apply the buddy system on availability of memory, then it will divide it into two buddies. Buddies means a friend of two student, you can say. A group of two student is called buddies. So we always divided the memory locations into two sub locations. So 1M can be divided into two part. And we know that 1M means 1M is equal to 1024 KB, or you can say K. It can be divided 1M is equal to 512K plus 512K. So if 1M divided into two part, then the two part will be 512K and other part will be 512K. So if the available is large enough from the requested, then it will be divided into two buddies, right? And after dividing two buddies or a two what we can say two partitions, two sub part, just wait. Okay, so we will satisfy the request of process 1 of size 100K. So what we have done right now, 1M we have divided in two parts, 512K and 512K. Again, we will satisfy or we will compare 100K with 512K. Whether it is a large enough block. If it is large enough block, can be divided 512 in two different parts. So yes, it is a large enough, we can divide it into two different part. So let's divide it into two buddies again. So 512 is still remaining. As it is, it will kept as it is. And these 512, that is the left hand side, will divide it in two different part. 256 and 256. 256K and 256K. And after combination of 256K plus 256K, it generates 512 size of memory. Now, after dividing 512 kilobytes in two different memory partitions, again, the first partitions we will take for the comparison. So 100K will compare to 256K. Again, the availability block is large enough. So we will think, can we divide into again our two buddies? So yes, we can divide. So again, we will divide it. Let's suppose this is the 512. We will not change 512, it will remain as it is. And 256, again, it will remain as it is. And these 256 will convert it into two different part. 256 divided by 2, we got 128k and 128k. Now again start comparing 100k, compare with 128k. Now 128k is further the large enough block. But remember, if you divide 120k in two different part, the first partition will be the less of size 100k, 64k and 64k. So we cannot allocate 100k of data in 64k of data, 64k of memory size. So we cannot further divide 128k of size of memory. So what we do? We allocate process 1, which required 100k. So we occupied 128 kilobyte of size of block into a process 1. So let's occupy it. It will be shift with process 1. So this is process 1 of size 100k. And maybe there is a wastage of 28k. So 28k is a very limited size of memory that are wasting. Okay, it is no problem. Okay, so let's continue. I hope you understand how we allocate 100k of size that are requested by process 1 and we allocate it in 128k size of memory block. But for getting 120k size of block, we have to divide it, the entire 1F memory, 1 megabyte memory in different buddies. So we always divide it in two parts. This is called the system of buddy. So if we have available memory, we compare with the process that are requested some different memory locations, different size of memory locations. So we do not allowed to load 100k into entire 1 megabyte memory locations. So what we do, we compare and we'll divide in two different parts. And the first part, again, we start comparing with the process. If it is large enough, then again we have to divide in two different part. Again we have to compare from the first part. If it is large enough, again we will divide into two different part. And again in the first part we will compare. If it is large enough, then it will be divided in two different part. If it is not large enough, then we have to load simple the process. So in this way, process 2, let's suppose process 2 comes. Process 2, which required a size, suppose 250 kb, or we can say k. So we will check which one is availability, which one block is applicable for allocating process 2. So in our memory section, we look at 120K size of block, that is less. It is not enough memory block. So we will skip that particular block. We will move ahead. There is a 256K of kilobyte of size of block. It is enough block. We require 250K and we have available 256K. So yes, it is large enough. We have already 512K block, but it is greater from the 256. So what we will do? We allocate process 2 in third number of block. So let's allocate. This is the process P1. 120K will remain as it is. And in 256, we will allocate process 2. And 512 will remain as it is. So we have allocated two processes in two different locations. Now let's suppose take another example. Suppose another process comes and he wants to execute, he wants to load into the primary section, primary memory, and it required suppose 60K. So every process, each and every process can have requested in different size of memory. So let's suppose process 3 requested 60K of size of memory. We will again check. First block is already allocated to process 1. Third block is already allocated to process 2. Second and fourth block is still remaining. So we will compare it with the second block. So 60K will compare. It is greater than, 60K is less than 120K. Yes, it is less than. So can we divide 128K into two different size? So yes, 64 plus 64, that is the two partition of 128 kilobyte of memory. And 64 will again compare it. 60K is less than 64. Yes, we can allocate that particular block to process 3. So what we will do? We will again make some buddies. Process 1 remain as it is. It will be converted to 64K. 64K. Process number 2. And this one is 512K. It will remain as it is. So here 64K, we can allocate process 3. So this is how we allocate a process to a primary memory locations by using the buddy system. One thing you have to remember, if process 1 gets terminated, if process 1 gets complete their execution, then process 1 should reclaim or release the memory. Release memory. Now how it will be releasing? So you have to create another block, and process 1, that is the block occupied by the process 1 and which is of size 256 kilobyte, so it will remain free. So 256K gets free from process P1. जस्ट वेट, प्रोसेस वन इज 100K, प्रोसेस वन इज 100K, सो 100K विल रिमेन फ्री. सो इट इज 100 प्लस 28, सो 128 वी हैव एलोकेटेड टू प्रोसेस वन. सो 100K विल गेट्स फ्री बिकॉज P1 गेट्स टर्मिनेटेड. P1 रिलीज द मेमोरी. So after releasing, it will be available for different process. Now 128. So here is process number 3. Now available is 64K. Now process number 2. And then 512. So one by one, we compare each process request to the availability of memory. If it is divided, then you can divide into different section. Then again, you can take first section and compare with the request. If it is large enough, then again divide by two section or two bodies. And after completing the execution, P1 will release the process. So each and every process gets release their memory locations occupied by itself. So finally, after completing the execution, we have still remaining 1 MB of memory. So somehow we divide the memory locations, gets process load in their data structure into the primary memory and execute it. And after that, it release the memory locations. So this is one kind of memory management technique that is called buddy system. So I hope you understand. It is a short note. Maybe in GTU there is a question, explain the buddy system with neat diagram, with explanation of diagram. So you have to make this kind of diagram. You can take your process as a request of different size, divide the blocks available, that blocks to the memory, and release one or two processes, and finally you got 1 MB of memory. So this is the explanation what we have done in today's session. This is the T representation of buddy system. The first 1M is divided in two different parts, 512 and 512. Again 512 will divide it into two different parts, 256 256, and will allocate according to the size of process. This is all about the today's lecture content. In the next session, we will understand some memory partitioning techniques.